Good morning and welcome back. Myself, Dr. Gibran Ahmed, presents to you Simply Pathology, and we are back with another very, very important lecture, that is amyloidosis part 1. So today we are going to read about the different aspects of amyloidosis, and here we are going to discuss about the introduction. Then we are going to discuss about the basics of amyloid fibril, what are the properties, the physical and the chemical properties. Then we are going to deal with the pathogenesis of amyloidosis, and then we are going to read about the classification. Okay, so basically, what is amyloidosis? So amyloidosis is basically a condition which is associated with a number of inherited and inflammatory disorder in which extracellular deposits of fibrillar proteins are responsible for the tissue damage and the functional compromise. So these abnormal fibrils, they are produced by the aggregation of misfolded proteins. So which are these misfolded proteins? So these are the normal proteins that have an inherent tendency to fold improperly, associate and to form fibrils, or these are mutant proteins that are prone to misfolding and subsequent aggregation. Okay, moving ahead. So these abnormal fibrils, they bind to a variety of proteoglycans and glycosaminoglycans. For example, most commonly the heparin sulfate and the dermatan sulfate. And because of the presence of this abundant amount of sugar, that is your proteoglycans and glycosaminoglycans, okay, it gives the fibril deposit the staining characteristic which resembles starch, okay, that is amyloid or amylose. Therefore, the deposits are called as amyloid, but remember that the deposits are unrelated to starch. So these abnormal fibrils, as I told you, number one, they are associated with proteoglycans and glycosaminoglycans. Number two, they are also associated with certain plasma proteins. Most commonly, it is the serum amyloid P component. So first of all, I just want to revise you is that in amyloidosis, there is an extracellular deposit of certain fibrillar protein. And what are these fibrillar protein? These are abnormally misfolded proteins, and these misfolded proteins, they can either be normal or they can be a mutant protein. And you have to understand that along with these fibrils, they can be associated with proteoglycans and glycosaminoglycans, which is giving them their, you know, staining characteristic, or they can be associated with plasma proteins as well. Okay, now moving ahead, remember that amyloid deposition always occur in the extracellular space, and the process is quite gradual. So on light microscopy and HNE stain, that is in hematoxylin and eosin staining, you will find certain amorphous eosinophilic hyaline extracellular substance. With progressive accumulation, it encroaches on and produces pressure atrophy on the adjacent cell. So this is how amyloid can cause damage, by causing pressure atrophy on the adjacent cells. Okay, and under HNE, they are amorphous eosinophilic hyaline extracellular deposit. So amyloid, okay, we use a special stain to see amyloid, that is a Congo red staining, which is a special stain. So under the ordinary light, they appear as pinkish or reddish deposit, but under polarizing microscopy, they will demonstrate an apple green birefringence. So let us see what how amyloid looks like in different okay, substance. So under HNE, under the normal light microscopy, it appears as an amorphous eosinophilic hyaline substance or deposit. So this is a HNE section showing kidney amyloidosis. So here are the deposit, these amorphous eosinophilic deposits that you can appreciate. In the second diagram, if you see, okay, this is the special stain that we do, that is the Congo red staining. Okay, so this is the Congo red staining of amyloid deposition in the kidney glomerulus. So these are the deposition, as we can see. Okay. Thirdly, now this is again the same Congo red staining. Okay, but now we are viewing under a polarizing microscope. Okay, so the apple green birefringence under polarized light after Congo red stain. Okay, indicative of amyloidosis. Okay. Now over here, a very, very, very important thing is, under the electron microscopy, you can find the amyloid fibrils. As you can see, these are the amyloid fibrils, as you can see, appreciate, these are the amyloid fibrils. Okay, and each of them, they are 7.5 to 10 nanometer diameter fibrils, or 0.1 micrometer you can say. Okay, so this is the basic size of amyloid fibrils. Okay, now we are going to start with the properties of amyloid. So what are the properties of amyloid? So there is a physical property and there is a chemical property. So remember that amyloid is not a single entity. Okay, so more than 20 different types of proteins aggregate and they form the fibrils with the appearance of amyloid. So amyloidosis should not be considered a single disease, rather it is a group of disease having in common the deposition of similar appearing proteins. So this is giving a uniform physical organization of amyloid protein. So if you look at the amyloid, so amyloid has a physical property and it has a chemical property. So first we are going to look at the physical property of amyloid. So remember, under electron microscopy, as I have already shown you before, they appear as a continuous non-branching fibril with a diameter of 7.5 to 10 nanometer. Again, a very, very important exam question. And under X-ray crystallography and infrared spectroscopy, okay, the characteristic cross beta pleated sheet conformation can be seen under X-ray crystallography and infrared spectroscopy. The characteristic cross beta pleated sheet conformation can be seen. And this basic structure, the beta pleated sheet conformation, is responsible for the distinctive Congo red staining and the birefringence of amyloid. Okay, so this is all about the physical property of amyloid. Now we are going to see the chemical property of amyloid. So if you see the chemical nature or the chemical property of amyloid, 95% of the amyloid is composed of fibril protein, as I told you before, whereas 5% of the amyloid is composed of certain glycoproteins. As I told you, the glycosaminoglycans and the proteoglycans, these are certain glycoproteins, certain sugars, and there are also certain plasma protein component that is called as the P component. So both the glycoprotein and the P component constitute 5% of the amyloid. So there are different kinds of amyloid. The three most common forms of amyloid, they are the amyloid light chain, also called as the AL light chain, amyloid associated protein called as the AA chain, and we are having the beta amyloid called as the A beta. Okay, now there are other less common forms of amyloid. One is your transthyretin, number two is your beta 2 microglobulin, and number three is your abnormal prion protein. So these three are less common, okay, but the more common ones are AL, AA and A beta amyloid. Okay, now let us move ahead. We are going to individually see the amyloids. So number one is called as the amyloid light chain, that is AL type of amyloid. So it is made up of complete immunoglobulin light chains, the amino terminal fragments of the light chain, or both. So it is made up of complete immunoglobulin light chains, or just the amino terminal fragments of light chain, or they can be made up both. Remember, most commonly it is made up of lambda light chain. Lambda light chain is most commonly used for making amyloid light chain. In few cases, the kappa light chains may also be present. Now remember that this type of amyloid is associated with plasma cell tumors. Okay, remember, this type of amyloid is associated with plasma cell tumors. So only in case of monoclonal plasma cell tumors, such light chains will be produced, which will help in formation of AL amyloid. So AL type is produced from free immunoglobulin light chain, which is secreted from the monoclonal population of plasma cells. Okay. Now the second most common type is the amyloid associated type, also called as the AA type of amyloid. So this type of amyloid is made from serum amyloid associated protein, SAA protein, which is made by the liver. So remember, how does this SAA comes into circulation? So the production of SAA or serum amyloid associated protein is increased in inflammatory states, and this form of amyloidosis is associated with chronic inflammation and is often also called as secondary amyloidosis. Now the third most common variety is the beta amyloid protein, that is the A beta type. Now A beta is 4000 Dalton peptide in weight, and it is derived from a large transmembrane precursor glycoprotein. It forms the core of the cerebral plaques found in Alzheimer's disease. So in Alzheimer's disease also there is your amyloid deposition, and that amyloid is your A beta type. Now the fourth most common or the uncommon varieties that we are going to start is the transthyretin. So it is basically a normal serum protein which binds and transports thyroxine and retinol normally. Now, TTR can be of two main types. Okay, one is the non-mutant type of transthyretin, that is the wild type, and another is that there can be a mutant variety of transthyretin. So remember, the mutant variety of transthyretin, they deposit in group of hereditary diseases called as familial amyloid polyneuropathy. So mutant variety of transthyretin is found in familial amyloid polyneuropathy, whereas the non-mutant variety of transthyretin deposits in the heart of aged person, and it is seen in senile systemic amyloidosis. Now, the other type of amyloid is the beta 2 microglobulin variety. It is a component, normally it is a component of the MHC class 1 molecule, and it is a normal serum protein. It is also helping in the formation of a beta 2m amyloid in patients on long-term hemodialysis. So patients who are on long-term hemodialysis, okay, they can also have deposition of amyloid, and the type will be A beta 2 microglobulin, and it is found in patients who are on long-term hemodialysis. Okay. Now, another your uncommon type is the APR. PR stands for prion. So in minority of the cases of prion's disease in the central nervous system, the misfolded prion's protein will aggregate in the extracellular space and acquire the structural and staining property of amyloid protein. So this type of amyloid protein is also called as APR. So now, one important question is that what is the role of serum amyloid P component? What does the P component do? Remember, the serum amyloid P component is contributing to amyloid deposition by stabilizing the fibril and decreasing their clearance. So this is how the P component is playing a role in amyloidosis. Okay. Now we are going to study about the pathogenesis of amyloidosis. Okay, how amyloidosis is occurring. So we have already read in the introductory part that amyloidosis is happening because of abnormal folding of proteins, which becomes insoluble. They aggregate and they deposit as the fibrils in the extracellular tissues. So normally, remember, the misfolded proteins are degraded intracellularly, that is inside the cell in the proteasomes, or they are degraded extracellularly by macrophages. So this is how normally the misfolded proteins are cleared from the circulation. But in case of amyloidosis, this clearing mechanism fails. Okay, and that leads to accumulation of misfolded proteins. So we have already read about how the misfolded proteins are cleared from the circulation in my lecture on chapter number 1. So if you go back to my lecture on chapter number 1, okay, cell as a unit of health and disease, there you will see how degradation of misfolded proteins occurs normally. And when the mechanism which is responsible for the degradation of misfolded protein fails, then and then only there is accumulation of these misfolded proteins, which gives rise to amyloidosis. So here is a very, very important diagram that you should draw in your exam if you want full marks. So first, I am going to tell you the basic. Basically, what is happening, that native folded protein, okay, so if it is misfolded because of any kind of mutation, it is going to give rise to an amyloidogenic intermediate, that is a misfolded protein. Okay, and that monomer will assemble to form a beta plated structure that is now called as a fibril. So this is the normal process of how amyloid fibril formation occurs. Now there are two things. Now amyloidosis can occur, because of two reasons. Either they can be because of production of abnormal amounts of normal protein, or it can be because of production of normal amounts of abnormal protein. So number one, the production of abnormal amounts of protein. So here, firstly, there can be an acquired mutation leading to a monoclonal B lymphocyte proliferation, which will give rise to plasma cells. And those plasma cell, those monoclonal plasma cell is going to secrete immunoglobulin light chain. Now, because of limited proteolysis of these immunoglobulin light chain, okay, they start to deposit, okay, as AL amyloid. So this is giving rise to the AL protein fibril. Okay, so this is the basic pathogenesis of AL type of amyloidosis. Secondly, when there is a chronic inflammation, there is an activation of the macrophages, which is going to release two cytokines, that is interleukin 1 and interleukin number 6, which is going to stimulate the liver cells to produce a protein, an intermediate protein that is called as serum amyloid associated protein, or SAA protein, which due to limited proteolysis, okay, they deposit as amyloidosis, okay, as AA protein. So as AA protein fibril. So here we see that because of production of abnormal amounts of the normal protein, amyloidosis can occur as AL amyloidosis or as AA amyloidosis. Now there can be production of a normal amount of abnormal protein. For For example, there is a mutation which is hindering the folding of protein, giving rise to a mutant transthyretin. They can aggregate and they can give rise to ATTR type of amyloidosis. So this is how this is all about the basic pathogenesis of different types of amyloidosis. Now we are going to study about the classification of amyloidosis. Again, it is very, very important. So amyloidosis can be divided into three basic varieties, okay? They can be systemic amyloidosis, or they can be hereditary amyloidosis, or they can be localized amyloidosis. So there are three important types of amyloidosis, okay? So there is a systemic or generalized amyloidosis, then there is a hereditary amyloidosis, and then we also have what is called as a localized variety of amyloidosis, okay? So now, very important thing over here is that what are the different kinds of amyloidosis under the systemic amyloidosis? So let us see. So under systemic amyloidosis, we are having primary amyloidosis. Okay, now the disease which is associated with the primary amyloidosis is multiple myeloma, and the major fibril protein over here is the AL type, and the chemical related precursor protein is the immunoglobulin light chain type. Okay, then we are having the secondary amyloidosis, also called as a reactive amyloidosis, which is associated with chronic inflammatory disease, and the major fibril protein is your amyloid associated protein, that is AA, and the precursor is called as serum amyloid associated, that is SAA. Thirdly, we are having the hemodialysis associated amyloidosis, which is associated with chronic renal failure, and here the major fibril protein is A beta 2M, okay, and the chemically related precursor protein is the beta 2 microglobulin. Okay. Now, the second variety of or the clinical pathological category of amyloidosis is hereditary amyloidosis. Now, here we are having familial Mediterranean fever. Now, here the major fibril protein is amyloid associated, that is AA, and the precursor is SAA. Whereas in case of familial amyloidotic neuropathies, the major fibril protein is ATTR, and the chemically related precursor protein is transthyretin. Again, we are having the systemic senile amyloidosis. Here, the major fibril protein is again ATTR, and the chemically related precursor protein being transthyretin. So the two major form, that is systemic amyloidosis and hereditary amyloidosis. Now the third important clinical pathological category is the localized amyloidosis. So there are four basic categories in case of localized amyloidosis. First is your senile cerebral variety, which is associated with Alzheimer's disease. Here the major fibril protein is A beta, and the clinically related precursor protein is APP. Now, secondly, we are having the endocrine. In the endocrine, we are having the medullary carcinoma of the thyroid. Here, the major fibril protein is A-cal. A-cal is the major fibril protein, and the clinically related precursor protein is calcitonin. In case of type 2 diabetes mellitus, the major fibril protein is AIAPP. That is your islet associated amyloid peptide, okay? That is your clinically related precursor protein. Then we are having isolated atrial amyloidosis. Here the major fibril protein is AANF, that is atrial natriuretic factor being the precursor protein. And then we are having the prion's disease, where the major fibril protein is APRPSC. Okay, so these are the different forms of localized amyloidosis that we know of. So this is all about the part one of amyloidosis, and soon we will be coming to the part two of amyloidosis. So thank you very much, guys, for watching this videos. In case of any doubts, please do subscribe to my channel and please do comment. Thank you very much for watching.